So do you want to make a difference in the world? Does anybody here want to make a difference with their life? Where one, slowly, yes? Okay, we've got some people that want to make a difference. I don't know if many of you remember the movie, and I definitely do, the movie Saving Private Ryan. And I know it's more than PG, but it's a powerful movie, a little gory. But at the end, there's a scene at the very end that always gets me, where he is much older and he is at the grave, and he is with his family, and I believe it's with his wife, and he's at the graveside of the men that gave their lives for him. And he is standing there and he turns to his wife, I think it is, and said, "Did I make it count? Did I make it count?" And we think about that. And I said, that's one of the most powerful things you can see as it relates to the Christian walk. Did we make it count? In other words, the sacrifice that Jesus paid for us, the price that he paid for us in giving his life for us, giving up his throne in glory, as we just sang about, do we make it count? And I believe when you ask someone, do you want to make your life count? Or do you want to make an impact in the world? People look at that and think, well, that's somewhat prideful to raise my hand and say, I want to make a difference. I want to be somebody that makes a difference and make my life count. But the reality is, I believe that we have that because we are created in the image of God, and we are created for a purpose. And he has given us that in our hearts, that desire to make a difference, because that's how he's created us to be. David knew this in Psalm 139. Verse 16 and 17, he says, "Your eyes saw my unformed substance; in your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God! How vast the sum of them." God is thinking about you and your days, even before you were born, and planning your life and giving you a purpose. So there's nothing wrong with having that purpose. So it's good to say, I want to make a difference, because I want to make a difference with my life because of what Jesus has done for me. And I want to make a difference in this dark world by being the light, as we saw last week. So in Ephesians 5, we were continuing through Paul's letter to the church in Ephesus, and there's two sentences that give us three keys to living a life that makes a difference. So it's verses 15 through 17, but it's just two sentences. And if you have your Bibles, and I hope you have your Bibles, open your Bibles to Ephesians chapter 5. And we're just going to look at those two verses. Verse 15, "Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise, making the best use of the time, because the days are evil. Therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is, and do not get drunk with wine, for that is debauchery, but be filled with the Spirit." I've gone one verse too far, but it ends verse 17 today, verse 15, 16, and 17. And that first key is verse 15. "Look carefully then how you walk, not as unwise, but as wise." Walking in wisdom. That's the first key to living a life of significance. And Paul encourages his readers to walk carefully, and the word that's used there is actually to walk with accuracy, to walk with diligence. And it's a precision applying to the way you walk and the way you spend your time and how you live your life. And the previous verse we looked at last week was verse 14, "Awake, O sleeper, and arise from the dead, and Christ will shine on you." Paul is encouraging his readers, don't sleepwalk through life. Don't just drift through life like sleepwalkers, but wake up and live with precision, live with accuracy, make a difference out of every moment of every day. And you know, I used to sleepwalk as a young man, and I've been cured of that, and I'll tell you how. Some of you know the story, but I used to sleepwalk a lot, and never did anything, at least that I know of, embarrassing. Probably did a lot of things embarrassing, but I was in the army in basic training, and I still was sleepwalking. It wasn't a regular occurrence, but one night, and we were sleeping about 40 to each of our barracks, and there were five dormitory or barracks on the base. And I climbed out of the window, because the windows were fairly low, and I walked around the base. Fortunately, I didn't get shot by one of the guards. And then I was, you know, knew it's time to go back to bed, so I'm sleepwalking around the base. And I climbed through a window thinking it's the same barrack, because they all look exactly the same. And you know what happened? I found the 10th bed from the corner. That's mine, right? Well, it wasn't mine. And I woke up. Fortunately, I ran before I got beaten up. But I woke up, and since that day, I have never walked in my sleep again. I woke up. It was terrifying. But so many Christians, sadly, are just drifting through life. Drifting through, sleepwalking, and haven't woken up. Woken up to the fact that Jesus gave his life for you to live your life on purpose. To live your life with a purpose. You know, if you're sleepwalking, and again I say, supposed Christians. Supposedly you're Christian, and people say, well, yeah, I went forward in a meeting and I know I'm going to heaven. I did the prayer and I'm good. But if you don't have that burning desire to make a difference with your life, that burning desire to live on purpose for Jesus, have you really encountered the living, risen Lord Jesus? Because nobody in the Bible, when they encountered Jesus, was ever the same again. Nobody, when you truly encounter the risen Lord Jesus, are you the same again. Look at the Apostle Paul, how when he encountered Jesus, his life radically took an about turn and he became a different person. Have you had that life-changing encounter with Jesus, or are you just simply sleepwalking, drifting through life? Paul encourages his readers. He says, but don't drift through life, but walk wisely. In other words, walk as the wise. And there's a vast difference between knowledge and wisdom. And many of you have heard this. Knowledge is something we can acquire. Knowledge is something that we can study books, we can watch a television and get an information from a documentary. Knowledge is something that if you spend the time, you can acquire. You can get it. But wisdom is given from God. Wisdom is a gift from God. Wisdom is knowing how to apply and use the knowledge that you've obtained as God would have you and direct you. Wisdom is a gift from God. Wisdom allows us to make sound judgments, gives us what to say in certain situations, what not to say in certain situations. That's wisdom. And it's a gift from God, something that God encourages us to ask for. James 1:5. If any of you lacks wisdom, does anybody lack wisdom? I think, well, if we're honest, we all lack wisdom. Ask for it. Let him ask God, who gives generously to all without reproach, and it will be given to him. Again, in Proverbs 2:6, for the Lord gives wisdom. From his mouth come knowledge and understanding. So, you know, walking in wisdom is not simply knowing where to go and what to do in a particular situation. Walking in wisdom is taking the knowledge that you have and asking the Lord what to do with it. It's a dialogue with God. How do I approach the situation? And God gives you the direction. Any situation or decision that you need to make, ask the Lord for wisdom, and he will lead you. You know, the ultimate mark of walking in wisdom is using what you have, what you know, and walking in wisdom with an eternal perspective. Every one of us have to have that eternal perspective over every decision that we make, every minute that we decide how to use it, have an eternal perspective on life. We're living for so much more than the temporal goals that the world around us tells us we should be living for. Having an eternal perspective is wisdom. Then secondly, in verse 16, Paul writes, making the best use of the time because the days are evil. Redeeming the time, that's the key to making living a life that makes a difference. Every moment that we have is a gift from God. The older we get, the more we realize how short life is, how quickly it goes by. You know, one of the translations, I think it's the NIV, says, redeeming the time. Redeeming the time. And the Greek word that's used there is the same word that's used for buying the freedom of a slave. So in those times, you could go and purchase the freedom for a slave. That's redeeming that slave. And it's the same word that's used for what Jesus did for us on the cross by redeeming us, paying for our salvation, purchasing our freedom. And the apostle notes that the days are evil. The days that we're living in, the days at that time in the first century are evil. They're evil today. And Satan would have nothing more than for you to waste your time being enslaved to the entertainment, being enslaved to the things of this world. You need to redeem the time. Make the most of every opportunity. You know, Satan loves for us to play video games, to watch movies, to binge on Netflix. You name it, whatever is wasting time. Satan's going to keep encouraging you to do that because you're in slavery. You're enslaved to that thing that's wasting your time, that's stealing away the time. You're missing out on the purposes that God has for your life because you're enslaved. And Paul encourages us, the Word of God encourages us, redeem the time. Set it free. Use it for the glory of God. Proverbs 6, verse 10 to 11 says, a little sleep, a little slumber, a little folding of the hands to rest, and poverty will come upon you like a robber and want like an armed man. My family would tell you that I'm obsessed with time, making the most of the time, and to a fault. And well, Debbie's in extended session, so there's no one here can, you know, she's probably shouting amen. But if we go on vacation, I wake up in the morning, we've got to make the most of this day. We've got 5 days. We're going to use this for the maximum. Let's, you know, wake up. Let's go. And I drive them crazy. They drive me crazy because I just want to sleep. I'm like, let's redeem the time. And so I become impossible to live with. But my engineering career prior to being in the ministry, one of the things I would spend a lot of time was doing project management, and I would help factories and production lines with their efficiency. So we'd look at a production line, find out where the bottlenecks were, come up with a machine or a system to help them to make the most of the time that they had to increase production. And time was money. So that was all about making the most of the time. But you know that we spend a lot of time trying to be efficient in our workplaces, but are we focused on eternity? In other words, making the most of the time that we have here in light of eternity. Do you know that there's eternal rewards for the way you spend your life here today? There's eternal rewards that Jesus is going to give out to us for the way we're spending our time, for the things that we're doing with our time. But don't miss this. You know, we're in a war. We're in a war for the time that we have. Satan and his demons are constantly, they're working to distract us. They're working to fritter away the time that we have rather than for us to be living on purpose for God. We're so consumed by temporal things. Sometimes we're, and more often than not, we're consumed by good things. But it's not the best that God has in store for us. It's easy to identify the sinful, the evil things, the things that we know we're not supposed to do, but it's good things that are replacing the best that God has in store for us. We should constantly war against those things. Our calling is to shine as light, as we saw last week. Our calling is to shine as light in the darkness, and that requires us to look at every day as an opportunity to be light in the darkness. So when the King of Kings comes back, when Jesus comes back, we'll not regret one day. Live a life without regrets. Then thirdly, Ephesians 5:17 says, therefore do not be foolish, but understand what the will of the Lord is. Knowing the will of God. This is one of the most common questions that I get asked in ministry. How do I know God's will for my life? How do I know what God wants me to do? And verse 17 begins with a statement, do not be foolish. You know, foolishness is the opposite of wisdom. Foolishness is not using our understanding with wisdom. Foolishness is speaking or acting without thinking. God has blessed us with the ability to reason. God has blessed us with the ability to think, to make rational choices. But that's not the complete verse. Verse 17 states, but understand what the will of the Lord is. And I've heard it said so many times in Christian circles, well, God has given us a brain to think, so we must make rational choices. You must make smart choices. Yes. But sometimes when you're doing the will of God, when you're called to do the will of God, it doesn't make sense. Sometimes when God calls you to do something, it's not rational, it's not logical. But God's calling you to do it. And people around you might say, you're not thinking this through. You're not using common sense. But if you're obeying the will of God, it doesn't always make sense. It doesn't always follow the predictable plans of logic and knowledge. So yes, God has given you a brain, but you need to submit your life to the will of God. That's a much more fruitful way to live. If we use our own intellect, if we use our own rational thinking, even our education, we will quite often miss the call of God in our lives. We'll quite often miss the will of God for our lives because we're planning it out ourselves. Many times we'll miss the best that God has for us. But if we live by faith, if we live trusting Him as a follower of Jesus, sometimes we'll go to places where we'll be asked to do things that make no sense. But we'll look back at it and see the glory of God. We'll look back at it and see how God used that illogical decision for His glory and His purposes. The safest, the most rewarding way to live your life is trust in God, to follow Him, and pray daily for His leadership and guidance. There's a Proverbs 3, verse 5 and 6. You know these verses well. And there couldn't be a more direct instruction in the Bible for exactly what I'm talking about. Trust in the Lord with some of your heart, and do not lean on your own understanding. With some of your ways, sorry, is my mic breaking up there? In some of your ways, acknowledge Him and He will make straight your paths. At least one person knows their Bible. No, trust in the Lord with all of your heart. Do not lean on your understanding. In other words, do not lean at all on your understanding. Lean on Him in all of your ways. Acknowledge Him. And then, what is the promise? He'll make your path straight. It's a promise of God's word. We can trust Him. You know, the will of God is not a mystery to be discovered. It's not a mystery to be discovered. It's a walk to be walked out. It's a lifestyle to be walked out. That's the will of God, to grow in our knowledge of God, to grow in our understanding of Him, and to be transformed in our minds so that we walk out this lifestyle of following God. Romans 12:2 says, do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, that by testing you may discern what is the will of God, what is good and acceptable and perfect. Knowing the will of God. So how do we know the will of God? How do we know the will of God for our lives? Over the years, I've had many opportunities to answer that question, but it began for me many years ago as I was just asking the Lord, what do you want me to do? And I've always gone back to Galatians 2:20. And I believe Galatians 2:20 is the crux of what it is to be a follower of Jesus, knowing the will of God. I have been crucified with Christ. It's no longer I who live, but Christ who lives in me. And the life that I now live in the flesh, I live by faith in the Son of God who loved me and gave Himself for me. When I come to a, a fork in the road and a decision point. I can stand there and I can weigh up the two options and I can whiteboard, which I often do, whiteboard the decision. But I say, it's no longer I that liveth. It's Christ. So, Lord, what do you want me to do? What direction do you want your life to go? Because remember, it's no longer I. So I'm faced with a decision that I know the Lord wants to go a certain direction. So I say, okay, I'm going to go this way, but if it's not your will, please stop me. And most of the time, the direction that I feel prompted to go is the right one. Sometimes God stops me. But we have to be moving. How do you get to that point? You moved to that point. You have to keep moving. You can't just sit there idly waiting for God to direct you or write it on the sky. He's expecting you to move in faith. Take a step in faith. It's not my life anymore. My identity is in Christ. My identity is in Christ. That's what the whole letter to the church in Ephesus is about, is who's my identity? It's Jesus Christ. You know, 23 years ago, many of you know the story, God told Debbie and I to come to America. And I was faced at that junction. And what did I do? I said, no, I'm not going. I chose not to go. 3 years later, after much pain and suffering, not being in the will of God, I said yes. And God directed our path. He opened doors miraculously. 16 years ago, I was working as an engineer in Atlanta, Georgia, and the Lord said, quit your job and join a mission organization. I said, okay, let's do that. 11 years ago, the Lord told me to join another mission organization and move to Hawaii with my family. Surprisingly, that was not an easy one. It was a challenge. And so we went, not knowing what the Lord had in store for us. We thought we were going to be there 6 months, and we ended up being there 2.5 years. And then, was it 9 years ago, the Lord said, move to Kansas City. Surprisingly, that was a much easier decision to make. And we came to Kansas City, not knowing what the Lord had in store for us. 8 years ago, God said, go to this church on a hill called Grace Point. And I remember I was sitting right at the back, kind of around there, you know. We all came in and sat at the back at one time, right? Nothing against the people sitting in the back. And the Lord said, I want you to stay and plug into this church. I want you to be a part of this body. And I said, okay. I wrestled with that. The Lord said, stay. I had no intention of being a pastor, let alone the pastor of this church. The Lord said, come here. The Lord has been directing my path each step of the way. But there's active participation in our part. We have to be moving forward. We have to be going. We must be walking. Discerning the will of God requires us to take one step after the other. And God is gracious. We take a wrong step, He just corrects us. And He nudges us back in line. Ephesians 2:10 shows us that God has a plan for our lives, for we are His workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand that we should walk in. God prepared those before we were born. He has a plan. We've got to be walking in them, as the final three words of that verse say. We were saved. As followers of Jesus, if you are here today as a follower of Jesus, God has a purpose for you to make a difference in your community and in your family. Psalm 119 verse 105 says, your word is a lamp to my feet and a light to my path. You know, Eric shared with me a great illustration about this. And you think about it, get in your car and you're going to drive to St. Louis. It's nighttime. You turn on the engine, you turn on the lights. Can you see all the way to St. Louis? Depending on your car, some of you can see further than I can with my car. I probably see 25 yards, maybe. But you cannot see the whole way, but you have to start moving. And as you start moving, you see more and more of the way. It's a lamp to your path. It's only as you move, you get to see more of the direction that God has for you. None of us know the full path that God has for us, but we have to keep moving because it's a light to our feet. It allows us, the ancient lamps could only see a few yards in front maybe, and you just keep walking in that, in faith. We have to be moving. God directs us as we move. You know, this is not just a message for young people. It's not just a message for people facing career changes or life choices. It's a message for all of us. If you're alive today, you're breathing, you're here today, God has a purpose for your life. He has a purpose for your life. He has good works for you to do. It's not just the big decisions of life. You know, when people come to me and ask me, what is God's will for my life? It generally is when they are facing decisions regarding career or marriage or studies, things like that. It's the big decisions in life, but it's the little decisions in life that God is directing our path. He is leading us. Walking in the will of God is a daily active choice making. It's daily walking, making choices. That's how we redeem the time. Every day you make 10, 100, maybe 1,000 choices every day of things to do, what to eat, where to go, redeeming the time, allowing God to lead you. So we know God's word reveals his truth to us. God's word speaks to us. God's word directs our path. God's word gives us insight and direction. But we also need to be praying. We need to be praying, being a people of prayer, asking the Lord for his will and his direction and his leadership. Our prayer journals need to be full of, Lord, what do you want me to do today? Lord, what do you want me to do in this situation? And as you're writing, I always write out my prayers, but as you're praying, asking the Lord, he will direct your path. And then we can seek the wise counsel of brothers and sisters in Christ, seeking the wise counsel of those that have maybe walked the pathway longer than us, people we can trust, and we can trust them with some wisdom and some counsel. And then look back at God's word and weigh it up against the scriptures. Frequently, also, God uses circumstances to direct our path. How many of you have had your path altered this year in the last 6 months? There's been some changes that have happened. We've all had to make some choices. We've had circumstances that have happened that have changed our direction. Romans 8:28, we know it very well. And we know that for those who love God, all things work together for good. All things, again, work together for good for those who are called according to his purpose. We can move forward without fear, without anxiety, taking the next step in our lives because we know our Father is good. Our Heavenly Father is faithful. In the earlier service, we sang that old hymn, Great is Thy Faithfulness. And it's so true. He is faithful. He is good. And that he sent his Son, Jesus, to live a perfect life, to die on a cross for us, and then rise again from the dead for us, to be saved for a purpose. So are you walking in wisdom? Are you walking in wisdom today, or are you sleepwalking? Are you just drifting through life? Wake up. Don't sleepwalk. The days are evil, as the word says, but we have to know that we are called for a purpose to walk in a purpose. God has so much more for you. God has so much more for all of us than we could even possibly imagine. Let's pray together. Thank you, Lord, that you know us so intimately, that you know us so well. Thank you, Lord, that you have called us, that even before we were formed in our mother's womb, you were thinking about us. You have plans for us. You created each of us for an individual purpose. Thank you, Lord, that you are good, that we can trust you, that you are faithful. Thank you, Lord, that your word has so many promises, so many rich promises that we can lean on in our trusting you. Lord, forgive us. Forgive us for squandering our time, for not using the time that you have blessed us with for your purposes, for your glory. Thank you, Lord, that you can redeem the time. And so, Lord, we pray that you would give us wisdom. Lord, give us wisdom as to how to utilize the days that you have given us, so that each and every day may be used for your glory, for your purposes, for us to be light in this dark world. We pray this in Jesus' name. Amen.